Star family, we are so excited that you decided to join us today. Whether you're in person or online, we say welcome. And now, stay tuned for what's trending at Living Word. Hey, Living Word family, the greeters and ushers need you. The ushers serve faithfully every Sunday at worship service. They serve at Bible study, funerals, and special events. The greeters and ushers ministry includes men and women who welcome and greet family with enthusiasm and love. We are always looking for more volunteers who have a heart to serve and who want to welcome people in from all paths of life. If you're interested in volunteering, please see Ms. Lula Hayes. Thanks. Sometimes you need a parent's night out. The Legit Young Adult Ministry is partnering with LWFC Kids to provide parents with a night out on Friday, February 18th from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. Parents, register your kids on the events page on our website. Or for more information, reach out to Ms. Sylvia Edwards. We really want to give all of our parents the break that they might need. Living Word family, it's Black History Month. Journey with us through Black History Month as we learn and explore all of the history of African Americans, Texas Black history, and even the history of our own city and Acres Home. And we even want to explore the history of our very own Living Word Fellowship Church. Our history is the cornerstone and foundation of our future. Observe the wonderful displays that are in the foyer and in the children's wing, and don't miss the Silver Star's annual Black History Program. It's focused on Black health and wellness. It'll take place Saturday, February 26th in Legacy from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. It's a great time to explore our richness and our culture. Thanks. Calling all men, come and join Men's Kingdom Building Bible Study on February 19th at 9 a.m. in Legacy. This is a study of the book by Charles Stanley called Landmines, and we'll learn how to avoid the dangers that get in the way of the believer experiencing God's goodness and His blessings. Men, you don't want to miss this special event. Hey, Living Word family. Do you have questions about the COVID-19 vaccine, how to quarantine, or especially about the safety of giving the vaccination to your child or teen? Well, our very own Dr. Judith Campbell, or as we call her, Dr. Judy, will be here in between services at 10 a.m. on February 27th to answer all of your questions. Also, check out our newly released interviews with Pastor Paul King and Dr. Judy on our YouTube channel. Send any questions you have for Dr. Judy beforehand to marketing@lwfellowshipchurch.org. For the latest information on COVID-19 prevention, please check out our website. We hope to see you on February 27th.
Finish the work to make me new. Breathing my life as a sacrifice. It's the least I can do. You gave it all for me. Now I'm free to live for you. You gave it all to me. And I give my all to you, Jesus.
You gave it all to me.
Be the glory. I want to give you a moment, make sure you have received your communion cups, and we're going to take a moment, let you just speak to our God as it relates to anything you need to speak to him about before we partake of this supper, this communion. give you a moment, and then we're going to pray, and then we're going to participate here. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you again for the fact that you did indeed give it all for us. And so, Father, we pray now that in this worship and the rest of our lives that we will give our all to you. And so we thank you again for the sacrifice that you made possible through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that we now can have fellowship with you because of his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And so, Lord, we remember that, and we give you praise, and we thank you for what you will do here today, and we give you praise. Let this worship now be in spirit and in truth, and we pray your blessings upon us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. It was on the night that Jesus Christ was betrayed by one of the very men who supped with him. And after he had given thanks, he said, take, eat, for this is my body. Let us eat. In the same manner, he took the cup and said, I will not drink this cup with you until I drink it new with you in the kingdom. Let us drink. Amen. Praise God. Father God, again, we love you. We thank you. We give you praise, and we ask now that as we continue to worship you in spirit and in truth, we thank you again for the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, everybody. It's your girl, Leek. I just wanted to welcome all new visitors. Those that are online, those that are in person. Thank you guys for coming. I did want to just do some housekeeping rules. We do ask that you keep your mask on over your mouth and your nose. Also, I did want to let you guys know that this week on Friday, we young adults will be assisting with the children's ministry to help just give the parents a break, and they're going to have a lock-in where you're only going to be there for a good 3 hours. So if that's something that you want to do and children's is something that you like, if you don't like kids, you don't have to come and do it. But if you like kids and you like helping out, then you can come and do that. If you want any help as far as how to get just the training for that, you can hit up Kieron or Miss Sylvia. Also, young adults, on the 26th of February, we are going to have, we're going to go to the Black History Museum. It's going to be for the low price of free, so you don't have to pay anything. And we're going to feed y'all. It's food. So it's food involved. I know, you know, darker skinned people don't like going to places if you're not going to get food. So just want to let you know it's going to be food there. That's it for announcements today. You guys enjoy the rest of service.
With all that's within, we are have paid the price to give us life. And with all that's within, we owe this praise to Him.
Tell me what can I do?
what can I do? 'Cause I can't live without you. I can't live without you. So tell me, what can I do? Oh, 'cause I can't live without you. I can't live without you.
Okay, let's start that over. Rewind, start over, play. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you. I'm excited. I know some of y'all are going, I'm single, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? Well, you know, I still encourage you to find somebody you can love and love them well. Be a good friend. Let's turn our Bible to 2 Corinthians. It is time for us to give to God, where we demonstrate our love to God, appreciation, and respect for who God is by the way we give. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, it says, verse 10 says, now he who supplies seed to the sower, everything we have, God supplied it, the gas, the air, everything, and bread for food, so that we could eat, will supply and multiply your seed. Is it just for us to get fat and wealth? He says, no, for sowing, so that he can increase how we live in respect of him, righteousness. You will be enriched in everything. So that's how he enriches you. For all liberality, back to giving, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. People could come here, they could be instruments, they could be worship, be a warm temperature in the sanctuary. People could say and worship God with a sincere heart. People can give praise to God. People can be healed, all because it became thanksgiving to God because of how you gave. And at Living Word, we make sure it does make a difference in people's lives. And it's not just you give. And we do selfish things. I want to say this before I pray. I'm not trying to push this on you. I'm just trying to serve you as your pastor. Dr. Judy Times will be here on the end of the month, on the 27th, to talk about vaccines for children. She is the vice chairman of the Education Department of Baylor School of Medicine. She's also responsible for diseases that impact children in the medical center, and she oversees all of that. And she is a medical doctor that is directly involved in the Texas Children's Medical Center. So she has been a part of our congregation for over 20 years, and I know her. And I know Judy gonna tell you the truth, whether you want to hear it or whether you like it. She will do that. So I pray, if you between services in the main sanctuary, that will take place. We've got some authors in our church. Love you go by the bookstore, and you'll find good books written by people that are a part of our church. So I pray that you would do so. All right? Well, let's bless God today. Let's give him praise today. Let us rejoice in the fact that God is great. He is powerful. He is mighty. Let's get the praise team back up in here. And let us give God praise for the glory of God, folks. Let's praise the name of God. Don't worry about this. Don't get it twisted. Don't worry about the football game today. It's just a bowl game because the Cowboys are not in it. So you don't have to worry about anything. Just enjoy your little barbecue and enjoy yourself. That was my 2 cents.
Hold your head as high as you can, high enough to see who you are, little man. Life sometimes is cold and cruel. Maybe no one else will tell you, so remember that you are black gold. Now maybe no one else has. black gold with the diamond soul.
We've got a lot of stuff in the foyer here. We'd love for you to go by. Mary Wheatley and a whole team of ladies have put together a great walk through history in the foyer. And in the children's wing, there's also a great work that has been done by Sylvia and her team. So you can walk through history and stop and slow down and read some of the things, not just look at some of the things that artifacts or different things that they've put together. Let's bless the offering. God, we thank you so much for what you are doing and what you have done. I pray, God, that we will not take it for granted, that we will always be thankful. We pray. Continue to let this worship service bring you glory and honor, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'll be committed to you. I'll never leave you. Nothing in this world could make me walk away. And no matter what life may bring, I'll be by your side. No matter what it takes, you won't be gone. 'Cause forever is a long time. That's how.
our release, the youth, our release, grade 7 to 12th grade, they are all released. I am, okay, let me do this the right way. Well, I'm glad to be back, and thank y'all for the birthday wishes. Let's start there. I did not like Kieran's impersonation of me. My voice is way deeper than that, as y'all already know. But I thank you for allowing me the break. I missed y'all. I'm excited to be back. I'm going to start off with a preface before we even pray, because I am approaching this sermon with caution. When you get to a, and I'm not going to even call it a church holiday or any type of holiday, when you get to a commercial holiday, which is Valentine's, which we all know is commercial, right, where they ask you to spend money. Some of us are last minute. Some of us are single and content, and this is not a holiday where you feel the need to celebrate. So I want to make sure I honor that today, okay? So sometimes when you preach a message, you get to a point where churches actually make you feel like you have to be married. When we all know that God has gifted many with singleness, and that is okay, and that is beautiful, and that is awesome, and that is whole. So before I even get into this message, I want to make sure I honor you, that this is not a push for you to get married or you have to find somebody. But then we have people who are single and seeking. It means you don't want to be single. And for those, this sermon also, I want to honor you as well. And then we got those who are dating. We got those who are married. And I say all those things to recognize you today because I'm going to try to make sure that y'all, this sermon is inclusive. However, I will also be bold enough to preach this word just how it lands. And I hope y'all are okay with that. So although I am making sure you are honored with my heart, I can only preach what is in the text. If I morph it just to make you feel like it's not there, then I'm not being true to what God has put in his word. Is that fair? All right, so that's my preface before we dive in. But let us pray together and let us get into the word of God because I am truly excited about it. Dearly Father, we want to stop and say thank you. You are absolutely amazing. And what to me is amazing is that we have an opportunity to learn something that is in your word that is beautiful. It is honoring. It is true. However, I do pray for our hearts, as many times a commercial holiday, not necessarily a church something, can only highlight the lack of or the absence of. But what I do pray is that it doesn't make us close our eyes and close our hearts to the beauty of what you've presented in your word. God, I want to say thank you for allowing every aspect and angle that there's nothing new under the sun. But I also pray that there is no eisegesis into this text, that we can get an exegetical approach to the beauty of what you've presented. God, I am thrilled to be in your service, and I pray that we're all thrilled to hear you speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, I'm going to say something real quick, and I hope my wife takes this well. I ran it by her, but maybe not in detail. Okay. I ask my wife all the time, how can I be a better husband? Now, here's the thing when you ask. You got to be ready for the answer. Now, most of the time, it's great news. She's like, you're doing everything amazing. You're a good husband. And it's still good news till today. But in the kitchen, she was feeling a little frisky. So I asked the question again. I said, baby, if you could pick one thing. It wasn't even date night. I just felt like asking. The kids were somewhere else playing. Everything was quiet. It was a good time to ask. And I said, baby. And she said, well, it would be nice if you were better with your hands. Yes. Now, let me tell you something real quick. We weren't raised like that. Okay. I'm being honest. Like, my dad fixed stuff sometimes when we didn't have money. It was a necessity fix. Y'all know what I'm fixing to say. Like, you're broke, so you learn how to change your brakes. Did you do it right? Probably not, but you didn't die. It's a necessity fix. So one time, yeah, I'm just giving you an illustration of what I'm saying. One time my dad fixed the sink, necessity fix. But the cold turned into hot, the hot turned into cold. He reversed the pipes underneath. Necessity, did it work? Absolutely. Did you burn yourself? Absolutely. So my wife, and she comes from a family of fixers. I mean, air conditions. I mean, go out and build a gazebo on a weekend just because you feel like it. It's a beautiful day. Who does that? And I knew I was up for trouble when I went to her house when we were dating in high school. And I was like, hey, I was just going to walk outside. I'm just that dude, you know, where you make sure you speak to the family before you pick up their daughter. And he's out there. And all the brothers are helping. I was like, well, she's screwed. But then, if I'm honest, I have had to try, despite my lack of ability, talent, handiwork, ability God-given, he left it out when he created me. I have decided that, you know what, I'm going to start doing stuff. Now, I do stuff, small, incremental projects. I have not gotten to a gazebo or anything on concrete. What I will do is hang pictures with a leveler. Don't judge me. I have now upgraded from pictures to shelving, floating shelves, chimney decorations. But then she said, here's the thing. This is what I'm going to vent real quick, and I'm going to get it. I got to move. If you know I'm not built like that, why you keep coming up with ideas? Here's the irony. Oh, baby, I saw this on IG. I don't care. I can't do it. And then we don't have the money to pay somebody to do it. We don't have that blessing. I work here. No, I'm joking. I'm blessed. So then she's like, I have this idea. I want to build beams onto, not the ground, the ceiling. Stop your clapping. This is not an amen service. Whoever put their hand up, put your hand down. We're going to be interactive today. Don't encourage this. So I'm getting to a point where I was flustered. But last Valentine's, I did the shelf. This Valentine's, I stepped it up. I'm going to the ceiling. Don't clap. But then I started to reflect on why. Because the why is what matters, why I'm on a ladder 8 feet in the air trying to hang something. The why is because I love you. Is it going to be perfect? Absolutely not. Is it going to look good? Probably not. And if you ever come to my house, do not look up and walk fast if you're underneath it. But I will say that love makes me work for something, though. You know what I come to think through, not saying everybody, is that sometimes we are content or complacent in love. Some of us haven't even tried to reach the ceiling of where you can go. Some of us even haven't get on the ladder to see if you can take a step up in your love. Some of us haven't even said, you know what, I'm content in my singleness, but is it because I don't feel like looking no more? Some of us haven't even said, you know what, the next step seems dangerous, but I'm going to do my best to put this all to work. And I'm not sitting here trying to preach a message. And if you want to do singles ministry after this message, go right ahead and you can meet right here at the altar. But what I will say is that some of us have gotten a little lazy with love. Turn to Genesis chapter 29, and I want you to dig deep with me today. I'm going to piggyback and go all the way through this passage, but I'm only going to focus on verse 15. In verse 15, I want you to get this, and I want to illustrate it well. This is one of my favorite love stories of all. But before we even get to love, I'm going to highlight something for you. In Genesis chapter 29, all I want you to do is turn there. We're going to start in verse 6 and 9. We're going to read it together. But before I even read it, let me tell you something. God was already doing the work. Hear me. God was already orchestrating the work. So before we even dive deep into you figuring out, Pierre, you're right, maybe this needs to change, that needs to change, I am single and content, I'm not looking for nobody, but that was a great message for me to send it over to my friend. But that may be the case. But before I even get there, I want you to understand the story of Jacob and Rachel. Jacob was sent by his parents away from who? Esau. Esau, he deceived. His parents were like, well, you need to go find you a wife. So go to my uncle who has a daughter. Now you're like, ooh, what? He goes, this is in the Eastern times. This was normal. They didn't live together, had families, were very separate. So it wasn't like you know, some of y'all at the family reunion start looking at your cousins a different way. I'm not endorsing that. This is not certain states. This is Texas. But what I will say is that they had what? He had to do something. Now, I'm going to get here with this. And on his way, in Genesis chapter 28, he has a vision from who? God. God then tells Jacob that he will be a father of many nations despite his deception. This is going to be important. So despite Jacob messing it up with Esau, God still had a plan for him to have a vision while he was escaping his past in which he created in his own selfishness. So therefore, you're like, well, God had to know. Hear me out. God had to know what Jacob's life pattern would be. And in the process, even though he was on the run, still had a love path for him. So before I even get closer to what I'm going to read in verse 9, I want you to understand the backstory that some of us are sitting here saying, I don't deserve love at all. Some of us have said, I'm content because I don't believe I deserve it. Some of us are saying, you know what, Pierre, you don't know. I've had kids. Some guys don't like that. Some girls don't like that. I have this situation. I have that situation. I have a past. I have that. And God's looking at you like, I already knew what your past would be like. I already knew that you would have an issue in your life. I already knew you made selfish decisions. I already knew that you thought nobody would love you, but I got love orchestrated for you. So even on your path, you think you're running from something, I'm running you right into something. So even when you think, man, I got to get out of this, and God's looking at you like, no, I'm running you right where I want to go. But make sure you follow counsel, though. Who's the one that sent Jacob? His parents. And his dad had to bless him first. Now, this is important. He wasn't on the run without permission. Some of us running from something to something without somebody saying you need to run from something. Hear me out. Some of us just run from situation to situation, date to date, relationship to relationship. You just running from stuff. You ain't necessarily running for God. And on your way, God says, hey, keep going. I'm going to make you a father of many nations. What you make sure of is that you're ready by God, so the person you meet is the place you're supposed to be. Some of us just run from to a person because they complete us, or we run to a person because we feel like that's going to make us feel better. No. The purpose of him finding Rachel was still the purpose to have many nations. So even when you find somebody, it's still purposeful. Even when you're married today, it's still supposed to be purposeful. You're not married so y'all can look cute on IG. This wasn't so you can post up and make sure people know y'all look good together. Because often what I figured out over time is that cute couples online don't have it all together after all. Because they look good when they met somewhere. She looked good when he found her at the club. They took the picture, they posted it, they got 1,000 likes, they had a whole bunch of hashtags, but when they got past the hashtags, their life was trash. So I'm okay if that's the life you want to live, but don't expect godly results if God didn't purpose that relationship. So then I stop and say, how many of y'all are living God's purpose, whether outside of the relationship, that means in your singleness on the way, Or how many of y'all are in your marriage still living out your marital purposes, which is to give him glory while creating the images of God as they walk this earth? So your kids are a reflection of who? The purposes of God, because that was the purpose of putting you together. He didn't put you together for pictures. And no offense, ladies or men, he didn't put you together so your wedding day looks amazing. America did that. They made marriage about a day, but God made it about the family. That's only the first point, that God was preordering steps. So if you know the rest of the story, this is where Rachel comes into play. Now I'm going to say hopefully some good things, but you're going to understand that there was some beauty to Rachel. The story is not just about Jacob. Just check out Rachel in verse 6 and verse 9. In 6 it says, "And he said to them, it is well." So now he's on his journey. He finally came to the land where he was supposed to meet his uncle. And it is well, and here is Rachel, his daughter, coming with the who? Sheep. Who was coming with the sheep? Was she accompanied by anybody? Who was taking care of sheep? Who was doing it by herself? This is what I struggle with men. Many men don't want a woman who's independent, can do her own thing, because that makes them feel insecure, because they don't need you. But wouldn't you want somebody that knows their purpose and ain't afraid of it? She was, watch verse 9, I'm not going to prove it to you so you don't think I'm tripping. Verse 9, while he was still speaking with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, and she was a what? A shepherdess. She was a title. She wasn't like she did it one day and she forgot because the brothers didn't want to pick up. There was no brothers to do. And in Eastern culture, the one of the ways where a woman could become a shepherdess was saying there's no sons to do it, so guess who would step up? The woman. And guess who was good at her job? The woman, because she was going to the right well at the right time of day to make sure she could feed all her sheep and she could take them back home. She was doing her what? Job. When you are single, and if you are single and seeking, stop seeking, but do your job. Because if you do your job, people will find you. Here's the problem. Yeah, Pierre, you're going to contradict yourself later in the sermon because you should be looking. You should be looking, because even in Eastern culture, you would find out that guess what? It was also a great place for her to meet other people, because guess who was at the well? Other shepherds. So she wasn't afraid of the shepherding club. She went to the well. She might have even wear her best staff, and she's showing people, look at my staff, and they compared staffs. It might have been a vibe. So what I'm saying is, if you're single, I'm not saying don't do your job and don't be open to the idea, but I'm not saying do your job so you can have somebody. Some of us only think we're content when we find the person, and then we stop doing our job. God's like, no. I gave you a purpose before you found a man. Fellas, I gave you a purpose. You were supposed to be a provider before you found a woman. It wasn't so you can get flaunt your stuff, get a good car so she can see you. No, wrong club. She met him while she was doing her what? Job. You know, another crazy thing, ladies, I'm going to say, I'll speak to you real quick. It was dangerous, too, because guess who's doing a job in a man's world? She was. I'll let you know in the commentary, even in historical studies, guess what was beautiful about it, but scary at the same time? They said this also led to men molesting women as they went and did their job, because you had to be away from your protection, which was your what? Father. So look, not only is she open, possibly, not only is she doing her job, but she's also in harm's way, because we had men who are predatory, and we got to start speaking on that, because many men have gotten away with being predatory. So she was in a man's world, and ladies, if I can just talk to you and sympathize with you, I know it's hard to live in a world dominated by men. But I don't want to discourage you either, because if God allowed a shepherdess, then he can allow you to function in this world with integrity and still do your job. But I had to speak on that. It ain't easy for ladies, fellas, and if we have any Christian men right now that are in the workforce, stand up for the ladies necessarily. You know this is unfair for them. You know they get paid less. Stand up for them. Pay them right if you're a boss. Don't pay them less than. They in a man's world sometimes. Shouldn't have to prove themselves. But watch what happens next. It gets better. We're going to go to verse 15. Then Laban, this is the father, Hey, I'm going to tell you something, man. Can I introduce Laban to y'all real quick? Just 2 seconds. This is going. It's not even the point of my sermon. Just let me introduce. Remember I told y'all Jacob was deceptive? He met his match. Laban was sneaky, like deceptive. You know the story. Laban was that dude at work that never paid you but always said the check was coming. That's Laban. Laban the one that lose your hours. You like, when you do the clock in, I lost it. Write it down for me one more time. That's that dude. But in a way, hear me out, isn't it crazy that sometimes we meet our match? Or God teaches us lessons of who we used to be by showing us that this is how it felt? Here's the problem. Is sometimes when God shows you somebody treating you the same way you treated somebody else, we blame the other person. God's like, no, I'm just teaching you what it feels like when you take advantage of somebody else. So don't get all alarmed. But let me also put this down, because it's going to get better. Watch verse 15. Then Laban said to Jacob, because you are my relative, this boy's sneaky, should you therefore serve me for nothing? He was on the run. He needed to stay at Laban's place. So obviously Jacob got to what? He got to work. So Laban, thinking he cool with it, said what? Well, then I'm not going to let you sit here for free. If you're going to work, amen. All right. It's going to come back on him in a second. Tell me what your wages should be. Tell me what I think I should pay you. Now, Jacob ain't dumb, but he kind of is. Now, Laban had 2 daughters. The name of the older, this is important, was Leah. Man, God is good how he ties stories together. Who was older out of Jacob and Esau? Esau. But watch the irony and the twist in this story. This could be a movie. You think I'm playing? Watch what happens. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Rarely in the Bible do they give you older, younger, but this is important to the story. And Leah's eyes were weak. Before I get into this, let me introduce something to you in an illustrative form so I don't offend nobody. When I was doing the project, you got to go to the hardware store. When you go to the hardware store, you got plenty of options. Here's the problem. If you do your research, you would know what you need to buy. But if you're trying to wing it, y'all didn't hear it. She was like, I thought I knew what I needed. The only thing Monica needed to choose, hear me out, was the different types of stain and everything else that could modify the project. Y'all know what I'm saying? She want dark stain, light stain, that she want, you know, she obviously in the dark, but that's not the point. So I was like, what do you want? So I'm FaceTiming her, but then, you know, you forget some stuff because you was winging it. But the whole point is that you get a chance to what? Modify the project according to your liking. There's nothing wrong with that, is there? So before I start talking about the difference between Leah and Rachel, just know that this was his preference. Just know that when you have a preference, that's up to who? You. That's why there's 15 different stains when you're fixing to stain wood. Because it's up to you, your preference. You know what I'm tired of Christians doing? Being ashamed to say they have a preference. If you have a preference, that's on you. The only thing I ask men and women to do with their preferences is make sure it's pure. Because we have allowed the world to shape what preference is. And we know what that feels like as African Americans, if we're honest. Because we had to make sure that we light skin was in, dark skin goes in, a natural hair went out, natural hair goes back in, perm was in. You know how many times they've said this should be your preference according to Hollywood? Where they wouldn't even cast a darker woman or a darker man because that wasn't the look that everybody was going for. So we know what preferences can do, and especially an impure preference can do. So my fellas, make sure that when you're single and seeking, make sure your preferences are not dictated by your lust. Because of your past addictions and present, are current in your eyesight, then you're only looking for a body part, not a woman. Now, ladies, I'm not done with you either. Because we know that y'all see stuff too. Thank you. I don't know what your type is, but I know you see your type. And don't tell me Hollywood hasn't pushed a type. Name a chubby man like me that's on top of covers, like on the cover of magazines. No dad bods have made it. They didn't pick man of the year from my model. They don't go bald. Like, this is not the look. So I say the same thing to you. Make sure your preferences are not dictated by your lust. Because your man can walk right past you, and you're too busy worried about a six-pack and boards and all these abs and leg muscles and all these things. And then, fellas, we passing by the same woman at church that's been loving the Lord, doing her shepherdess duty, but you're like, that's not my type. Maybe your type is a little bit biased. Sinful is a better choice of words. But Jacob had a type. But before I get into her eyes are weak, can I say this? Yes, her eyes were weak. But it doesn't mean, I've heard preachers say that she had cross-eyed. Or a lazy eye. Hear me before I finish this one, because I knew it would take me a second. I gotta go fast. Those aren't true, but it makes the story a lot funnier. She was like, nice to meet you. He was like, nope. Which one? No, I'm joking. That's not true. In the Eastern times, what did they cover up? Their face. So the word means that it lacked luster to him. Hear me out. Nothing about cross-eyed and dim-eyed and she couldn't see. He was saying that out of all the things he could see, her eyes were not attractive to him. They lacked the bedazzling quality that Rachel had. Now, this is going to get better. So when he saw Rachel, he was like, ooh, that's her. When he saw Leah, he was like, that's not my type. Her eyes don't do it for me. And I'm going to prove it to you. If you just look into the Hebrew, it says it lacks charm to the person. It would say the lacking of a sparkle or fire. This has nothing to do with what? Cross-eyedness, lazy eye, nothing of the. It lacks what? Fragility or vulnerability or tenderness. So he's saying, when I look into her eyes, I just don't feel like that's my type of eyes. But then he saw Rachel. Oh, this is good. Because then he saw Rachel. Watch what he says about her. And Leah's eyes were weak, but Rachel was beautiful of form and face. So I looked at those words because I was wondering why he used what? Form and face. But both words just mean she was beautiful to him in her appearance. That's all it means. So it's not like he was objectifying her and looking at her body. That's the first thing I'm sure our minds went to. And then said her face was beautiful as well. It just means that in everything that I can see, she's beautiful to me. So therefore, what should you be looking for? Somebody who's beautiful to you. Does it matter what your friends say? Does it matter what your girls say? So when you bring them to the girls group and everybody's like, are you sure? No. That's beautiful to you. I don't care if your friends think he's Leah. I don't care if he, you know, pigeon-toed and bow-legged, but if that's your thing, let him have it. I mean, he's like, sup, girl? And you like, I've always wanted that bow-legged dude. Oh, boy. If that's your thing, let him have it. Obviously, it worked for my mom. My dad bow-legged. It's time for ushering. Bless him. It worked for mom. I was like, ooh, I like the way his legs make a diamond shape. Can I get off topic for a second? Because it's going to be really, this is my favorite story, my mom and my dad. Obviously, something about my dad's legs. I don't know. She never mentioned his face, but his legs, though. So I never realized he would always walk around the house with red shorts. But I'm not talking about like Nikes, hooping shorts. Like, I'm talking about red shorts, like, boom, like old soccer shorts from college. Y'all know back in the day in the 70s, them shorts were short. But he would always come out the house or out of his room with the red shorts on. And me and my brother would be like, cover yourself up, buddy. But you know what I realized? That wasn't for us. That was for mom. He came out the room stunned, walking totally different. Flexing for no reason. You want eggs? Now his legs wasn't for us. That was for her eyes and her eyes alone. You know what I love about the story? Jacob could care less about anybody else. He didn't want Leah. He didn't want somebody else's proposal. He just wanted the woman that he found attractive. And for you, I think sometimes in our marriages and in relationships, we have allowed the beauty of what she is today and what she was and what she will be to be dictated by our own problems. The reason that you had eyes for her then should be the same reason you have eyes for her now. But here's the problem. If you only married her for her beauty, that's gonna fade. If you only married me for my handsomeness, which is already fading, I had hair, it faded, then it's gonna fade. Our love will fade in physical form. And you know why I know that? Because the story moves on. It doesn't say that was it. But in America, guess what it says? That's it. If you find them attractive, you date them, and then you see what happens. But no, no, no. The story gets even better because it says she was beautiful, but then it goes on and it says this. Remember, I was talking about wages, right? Now, Jacob, what's this word? Loved Rachel. It's okay to have a physical attraction. Song of Solomon will teach you that. But after the physical attraction, there has to be something else. And this is where marriage starts to come into play. I know y'all were thinking I was doing a dating sermon the whole time. Watch this weave real quick. Because love never fails. So if you loved her back then, you should love her now. But I'm going to give you the definition of love just to make you uncomfortable. Love in this sense had nothing to do with sexual attraction. You know how they know that? Because they use a different word for Tamar when she was raped. Totally different word because it had nothing to do with Tamar's expression all the way back when David's daughter was raped. That he said he loved her. No, 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 no. He had a sexual attraction to her. Two different words. But when you get to this word, all it means is I have a desire for intimacy with you, not physical. I want to get to know you. But not only do I want to get to know you, I want to get to a point where I work to love you. Love is often used for a desire or attraction with the end goal of what? Marriage. So can I speak to this? If somebody says they love you but are not working towards a goal, that ain't love. If somebody says, I want to be with you forever, I love you, but they're not working towards an end game, which is to give God glory and to meet you here at this altar, that ain't love, that's lust. Love has a game to it. It has a work to it. It means that somebody's going to work for it. But if they don't want to work for nothing, that ain't love. Because love, last time I checked, is a verb. If you go all the way to 1 Corinthians 13, it says what? Love is a what? Verb. It acts. It does something. So that means love is patient. Love is kind. Love is this. Love is that. Love never fails. Love this. So when they say they love you, they should be working their tail off. They should be putting things in the ceiling, even though they don't know what they're doing. You better like it. I'm tired, boss. That lasted till 10 last night. Still not done. The word love is not just describing affection, but is describing somebody's desire, attraction that causes someone to work. How do I know that? Let's go right back to the same word. What was that word I told you? Wages. So what did he want from his father-in-law, soon-to-be father-in-law? His daughter. Now, this is where the story gets interesting, because I truly believe I loved it. He says, I'm going to work for it. Watch the rest of the verse. So he said, I will serve you for how long? 7 years. Now, there's some historical background to this going to blow your mind. All right, let me get back to this real quick. I went to the hardware store. I got the wood. I got everything I needed. I came home. Things didn't go right. I didn't know walls could be crooked. Till today, I still think that's a lie. I think my cut was crooked, but that's not the point. The wall was crooked. So guess what I had to go back and do? Buy more wood because my cuts were bad. So I had to go back again. Then last night at around 6, 7 p.m., I said, oh, shucks, I need more wood. Or I need them to cut it because my wife said, that 12-inch beam going to look crazy. We need a 7-inch beam. I was like, what baby wants, baby gets. So then I went back to Home Depot. So I had to cut the wood that was $25 each plank. I ain't got money like that. So I'm like, nah, we're going to make this thing work. So I cut the wood because the first time I drove home with 12-foot wood in my trunk, the trunk was wide open. That's not safe. But I made it home because God is good. I get to Home Depot and guess what happens? The dude was like, oh, my fault, bro. We don't cut wood less than 12 inches. So I was like, well, that doesn't make sense. So I was like, no, just slide it in here, bro, 7 inches. He's like, I can't do it. So guess what I have to go do? I have to go buy more wood that's 6 inches or 7 inches. So bottom line is I get back to the house. Now it's 8:30. I start to put it together. I start to put it up on the wall thinking I've done everything else right. The thing don't fit. That's what love is. Love is going back and forth to the store, and you're going to put in that work. You're going to go back and, hey, say, can you cut this love differently? Yes, I can. Oh, no, I can't. All right, let me go back over here. Let me go buy and invest more in my relationship. Okay, cool. Date night didn't work last time. She don't really like this type of food. Let me go back to this type of food. You know what? Oh, she really loves this kind of flower. You know what? Let me write that down. I'm going to put in the work. And if it takes me 6 trips and 10 hours, the work is necessary if she's worthy of love. And if I not only find her attractive, but if I love her, I'm gonna put in the work. Here's the problem with marriages. Is the longer we get in them, is the less we work. We treat it like a job, don't we? Some of us know how to shortcut our jobs, don't we? Some of us get to a point where we're like, you know what? I know her, so I know I'm gonna get the same gift. Vow she like flowers. You don't try nothing new. You haven't stepped up on that next ladder. You haven't said, what's next? What can I do? You haven't said, you know what? Let me go back to the store and figure out something different. My biggest fear, ladies and gentlemen, I'll admit this on public, is that my love for my wife gets stale. This is my biggest fear. People always ask, why you keep doing this? Why you keep planning dates? Why you always trying to find something romantic to do? Because I don't ever want, no matter if we've been together 20 years dating, 16 years married, I don't ever want to get to a point where like, that's good enough. That's it. And people are like, Pierre, why don't you just buy the beams and let somebody else install it? Because I want to show her that she's worth the work. So I'm asking you, what is the beams in your marriage? How many times have you went to the hardware store? Who are you dating right now that needs to see a different side of you? And stop falling for the trap that this is just me. That ain't you if you can change. I'm not talking about changing your character. I'm not talking about godly character, your purposes, your goals for your life. Nah, keep those. I'm talking about when you like, I have an attitude that black, you gonna love me or not. No, no, no. If you love somebody, you are willing to what? Change. You gonna work. That means the next time you're in an argument, you ain't gonna be like, well, this is just me. No, it ain't just you. Change you. Because that you is offending me. And if you love me, you gonna change it. The last time I checked, if you didn't work or something, it's going to die. And so don't be alarmed when all your dating relationships fail. And stop blaming every man you and every woman you meet. That could just be you. And all you're doing from every relationship is just begging somebody to fall in love with you without changing you. It just don't work like that. Because he says, you know what? I worked 7 years for her. You know what's crazy about the historical background of that? In servanthood, you're only supposed to work six. Oh, excuse me, you work seven. But if you do the math, guess how much it really cost for marriage back then when you did your gift? 10 shekels. So guess what this man just did? He overpaid for her. Now, this is beautiful. If you were smart, you would have said, how many shekels do I need? How long does it take me to get to these shekel amounts? And then now I'm done and I'm gonna bounce. No. He said, because I see the value in her, I can care less what you're gonna charge me. Because she's that valuable, I'm gonna work because I feel she's worth 7 years. Oh, this is good. So I don't care what you think she's worth. I know she's worth this. So you don't even have to. Who set the premise? Did Laban say, give me 7 years? Who's saying that? I will serve you 7 years. Isn't that beautiful? You would have thought Laban would say, hey, give me seven, see if he can stretch it a little bit. Nah, Jacob was like, she's so beautiful to me. I love her so much, I'm fixing to give you seven. So then I asked you, how many of y'all ain't waiting to did your seven? And if I could talk to the dating folks real quick, if somebody ain't willing to wait for what's valuable, then he don't see the value. If he ain't willing to wait on the goods, then he don't know the value of them. We can talk about that sexually, or we talk about that as a person. Ladies, if you're not willing to wait and work at your marriage or work at your premarital or work at some dating stuff before you get married, everybody's in a rush to the altar. And I'm like, have you worked at your relationship yet? Because it ain't going to fix itself once you stand here. Like, me saying I do ain't fixing your bad attitude. You're going to have the same attitude you walked up here with, the same attitude you walk out with. And no offense to y'all, you might not want me for premarital counseling. Because I'm going to tell you that in your premarital counseling. And I've looked dudes and ladies straight in the face. Are you willing to deal with that for 50 years? I tell them that all the time. They be like, well she told me she's going to change. How long y'all been together? 3 years. Has she changed in 3 years? No. Well, she ain't finna change. Now, I give God his due, and I say if she's growing spiritually or if he's growing spiritually, there's hope. But I hope you know the first 3 years, it might happen again. And she might relapse or he might relapse too. My point is, it takes what? Work. But watch the ending and the beauty of this message, because you thought that was the most beautiful part, but it just gets better. Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than to give her to another man. Stay with me. So he agrees. This is a deal. We shook hands. The wages have been agreed upon. So Jacob served, watch these words, for 7 years. For who? All right. You're going to understand how bad the story gets. But watch these next couple words, man. This is the love story I wanted to get to for you. Read it with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and watch it read this, they seemed to him but a few days. But watch the why. Because of his love for her. This man worked not inside the house labor, I'm talking about outside the house labor, for seven straight years. I want to paint a picture. Every day he would get up in the morning, go do what Laban said. Every night he would go to bed, wake up, and the whole time he couldn't touch Rachel. That means that he couldn't go and act like he was his wife. He couldn't make sure that she was cool. They may have been talking, but they couldn't do nothing else. No touch, no nothing. Because that would have dishonored the agreement. So this man for 7 years said, I'm going to go toil in your fields, not mine. Now picture that. He ain't making himself no money right now. For 7 years, he ain't made himself no money, but it said it felt like a few days. Oh, this is love. People are like, hey, Pierre, how long you been married? I don't know. It's 16 years. I can give you the number because you can't forget when you get married because it's sentimental value. But it feels like a few days. We were looking at pictures when I had hair. I was like, bro, that feels like yesterday. Because when you're in love with somebody like Monica, it's just a few days. When you wake up next to your best friend, it's just a few days. When you get a chance to light some candles on Count Valentine's, even if you don't got a lot of money, it's just a few days. Even when you go through your rough patches when we couldn't get pregnant, it's just a few days. Even when I rubbed her back when she was crying because we were both wanting to have a child, it's just a few days. Even when there's her bad days, when she wakes up and she's not in the best mood, it's just a few days. So you want to find somebody who's just a few days, but if they get tired of you too fast, you wasn't worth it. So I want to ask you, how many of y'all in your marriage have said, I'm tired of it? That's just showing you don't love that person, not because they're a bad person. You gave up. Because if you love them, you gonna work for it. But you gonna work for the one you want. Because if you know the rest of the story, he didn't get the one he wanted. I want you to hear this one. Because of his love for her. So if you're single and content, enjoy. Serve the Lord, because in 1 Corinthians 7, it tells you what to do with your singleness. If you're single and seeking, do what God's called you to do. But be open-minded that somebody might be at the well for you. Don't close your eyes because of your last and past relationships. But if you are dating, put in the work. If you're married, keep the work. Because it's only going to feel like a few days. If I can summarize the story and conclude the story, it gets better. Laban deceived him. As you know, Eastern tradition, you can only see, they cover the person with a veil. And that veil stays on until you consummate. Okay? And then you can uncover your bride. Obviously, this man did not look at Leah's hands or anything else. It must have been dark because he didn't see her eyes. So finally in the morning, he realizes, man, that ain't Rachel. That's Leah. So Laban tricked him. And then guess what Jacob did? Worked another 7 to get Rachel. That's the type of man you want. That's also the type of woman you want. Because the last time I checked, marriage was for the lifetime. So 7 plus 7 only means 14 years in order to get what I want. So I ask you, some of y'all right now, how many of y'all are still working at your marriages? How many of you are doing your 7 plus 7s? How many of you are doing real love and how it acts itself out? And then I'm going to ask you a harder question. How many of you are trying to improve your love? Or how many of you just figured out how to be routine? Because routine doesn't mean love, because love is continually advancing. It's getting better. So that marriage should get better with time. Not just because you know each other better, not just because y'all can put up with each other, not because you know her habits and her routines and vice versa. It's because you're constantly trying to figure out how to exude God's love on somebody else. You know, the last time I checked, God's love never had a limit. Have you ever thought about that? How many times have you modified how you sin? Hear me out, and I'll close. How many times have you done a different type of sin but the same thing? And then God says, oh, you're forgiven. How many times have y'all went off the path that God has purposed for your life? And God says, I can redirect you. And God's sitting there saying, if I can love you, then how come you can't love somebody else? Especially somebody I wanted to put in your life in the first place. Because if you marry Rachel, which he did, and he married Leah, which we could talk about another day, we all know what? That the promises of God were done. But you got to stay in that marriage to get it done. You got to fight for your marriages. You got to fight for those relationships that are worth it. Because if you do, watch God's promises come true. So, we're done now. So I'm driving home, I'm holding a string. This is not good, it's bad. I didn't know how to close my trunk because it couldn't close, it was too long. So I decided to hold the string attached to my trunk while I drove with one hand. Yeah, it was bad. It's bad business, what I just did. I put my blinkers on, though. I get home. Last night, 10 o'clock, I told y'all I tried to put it up. It got stuck, didn't go. So my wife, the smarter one, gets up on the ladder with me. I made some different cuts, modified my cuts, went back to the cuts, dented the walls, binged up the walls, actually turned up the walls like they're all jacked up now. Don't look up. And the bottom line is, at the end, around 10 o'clock, the beam was placed. I'm not going to say hung well, placed in the spot that I thought I designed. Does it look good? No. If you ever look, there's a gaping hole on the right side because I didn't make a right cut. But my wife looked at me and she says, "Thank you." I know she can see the hole. Monica, the one thing you're gonna know about my wife, she can't hide facial expressions. She was like this. I mean, I can see the hole. But that's what marriage is. Sometimes you're holding on by a string, y'all. You're like, "Pierre, I can't make it." I'm just challenging you to get home. Make some different cuts. Bring home new wood. Make some different cuts. Even if you're holding on by a string, like, "Pierre, you don't even know, I came to church in an argument. I came to church not feeling valued and loved. I came to church hoping that she would love me better or he would love me better. I came to church hoping that Valentine's would pass without her wanting anything other than flowers because she don't deserve it. I came home thinking, man, if I had to live with this woman for another 20 years, something finna shake." But all I want you to do, because it's go home, go back in your garage. I want you to make new cuts. You're going to ding your walls, ladies and gentlemen. You're going to scratch some things. It's not a perfect cut. You're going to make some things happen. And when you finish, you're going to look up and it's like, it's not exactly how I planned it when I stood at the altar. But it's on the wall. And God can fix any mistake, but you at least got to try to hang it. My prayer for you today is you'll try to start hanging it. And not just for a day, because Valentine's is commercial. Marriage is a lifetime. Dating is something, a choice. It has a purpose. Singleness has a purpose. Don't mistake these things without doing the work. Can we pray? I want y'all, I know it's a relational sermon, and some people like them, some people like, you know, I just want to hear a whole bunch of theology, and I get it, we'll get back to it. But for some people who came here like, "Pierre, man, I haven't been loving my loved ones better." And you can even say, take this sermon and take it to your family. If you're like, "Pierre, I'm single and content," take this sermon to your family. Have you loved the people that are in your life better? Can you love your friends better? Can you ask people how to become a better single? But for those who are dating, single, and seeking, are you doing your job? Are you serving in the church? Are you doing what God has called you to do? Are you fulfilling your purpose? For those who are dating, is there ways in which you can increase and make sure you love that person so you can show the love of God? And if you're married, and you're like, "Here, you know what? I've just kind of settled down. I've not sought how to love my husband or wife better. I haven't asked myself how I can be better so I can love better. I haven't done any of the work. I'm just sitting here." This sermon, although it may not be for everybody, is for someone who said, "You know what? I need to get back to work." My prayer for you is that you'll not only do it on a day, you'll do it every single moment you have a chance in the morning. So this sermon's for you. You can choose to stand while Chris sings, or you can come to the altar as we conclude service.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
You know me, I always give one more chance to do it. Here's a funny thing. I'm going to say this the right way. If you don't want to stand, but you know, just know, Because the last time I checked, we could all work at being better lovers. So I'm not asking you, even if you're like, Pierre, I'm uncomfortable standing because that means I got work to do. I'll stand with you because I got work to do. But I'd rather you commit to work than to sit and do nothing with your conviction. And again, I'm not forcing you. I just don't want people sitting here saying, I'm good. I don't want my wife knowing I'm going to work harder. I don't want to commit to something I can't do. What you're telling God is, I know I can work better, work harder. I know I can be a better single. I know I can serve. I can work. That's what the commitment is. So if that's you today, when he sings, when Chris sings, I challenge you to come or to stand where you are so that we can all continue to be better at love.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Well, I'll say this. It's so wonderful to see this many people to stand. And it's not about Valentine's. Move Valentine's out the way. What I'm loving seeing people stand and says, I can be better at showing God's love. Everybody can. I'm standing with you on this one. I'm never going to stop trying to love my wife better. That's my commitment to you today. I just want her to know that she's loved with a godly love. My kids the same way. My family the same way. But I can always be better. What I want to do for all those people who are standing out there, hey, amen to your convictions. I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to love on you, but we're going to go home and we're going to do the work now. So if you're single, you're like, Pierre, this sermon was just me saying I'm going to commit to be better, being a better single. Amen. Let's start the work. Dearly Father, we are thankful that you always give us an opportunity for the people at the altar, for the people standing and saying, I can love better. There's a way to improve my love. I know in ways in which I've settled and said that's good enough. And today I'm saying, no, it ain't good enough. I'm going to be better. I can't keep saying this is me. This is who I am. This is just our marriage. No. We can always seek to love somebody like Jacob loved Rachel, where the works felt like days. So my people that are standing and the people who are sitting that say, you know, Pierre, I don't want to stand. I just pray that they realize that that person that's sitting next to them, they're thinking about that family member they're thinking about. When you love somebody with God's love, it just feels like days. To keep trying, to keep seeking, to keep loving. God, I love for the people who are humble themselves here. I pray that you'll convict them anytime they stay away or they get lazy in their love, and they'll get right back to work. Nobody's going to be perfect when they leave this altar or when they're standing, but what they can do is be reminded of the commitment they made before you to love better. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. And thank you. Well, you made it. But to me, you never make it through a sermon, right? My prayer is that everyone in this room grows. But at the same time, we always can make some commitments. And you know me, I'm always going to offer the same three things. You're saying, hey, Pierre, I don't have a church home. And I want to make this my home. We'd love to have you. Pastor Lawrence is to my left, your right. We would love to have you here at Living Word Fellowship Church. I got the chance to walk in on some new members that were joining the church. And it was a blessing to meet new faces because the pandemic kind of stops that. So I'm thankful for the people that are joining, and we would love to have you join. We're not a perfect church, but a church that's seeking to love better. If you don't know who Jesus is, this is important. And you're like, Pierre, I don't even have a relationship with God. I came to church and I'm trying to find out what God is. We would love to explain that to you. We want to be a part of that journey with you. I will take my time talking with you because we want people to experience what salvation feels like, because you can't love without God. So when you get saved, you can exhibit God's love because God indwells you. So therefore, we want you to get saved. It fixes helps fix things in your life. Lastly, if you need prayer outside of just the sermon itself, we would love to pray with you. The Bible talks about elders praying with his members and with the church. And if you're just saying, Pierre, I need health, I have some concerns, I want to pray with the elders, we would love to pray with you. Come to my left, your right. Me and Pastor Cannings will meet you here. Any other elder here, we'll pray with you. We would love to do that. Well, I'm excited. Next week, I just want to give you a heads up. We're going to kind of dive into some Black history stuff. not necessarily Black history, but talking about some beautiful issues in the Bible that we should address. And I'm glad Pastor Canning has given us 2 Sundays to do so, because we want to figure out what the Bible says about issues going on in our world. For the next 2 Sundays, we were glad to expose that to you, to give that to you. For those online, we would love to talk to you about that as well. We're excited about what God's doing here at Living Word Fellowship Church. If you don't mind, can we stand together? And let's sing and worship God for who He is and what He's done.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps Himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at His voice, and trembles at His voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, we'll sing, how great is our God? Sing one more time. How great is our God? Say, sing with me, how great.
Challenge for you as you leave, and I'll pray. If you're not married, ask somebody else how you can love them better. If you are married or dating, ask that person how you can love them better. Receive that response, and if it lines up with the Word of God, try it. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You for the opportunity for us to be in what You've created us to be, which is to be loved and to give love, because You are love. So I do pray that we will let people see Your love in our relationships that we have today. I pray that our love will get better and we'll take some steps to always exhibit Your love to other people so that they can see You. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
Family, we are so excited that you decided to join us today. Whether you're in person or online, we say welcome. And now, stay tuned for what's trending at Living Word. Hey, Living Word family, the greeters and ushers need you. The ushers serve faithfully every Sunday at worship service. They serve at Bible studies, funerals, and special events. The Greeters and Ushers ministry includes men and women who welcome and greet family with enthusiasm and love. We are always looking for more volunteers who have a heart to serve and who want to welcome people in from all paths of life. If you're interested in volunteering, please see Ms. Lula Hayes. mistake. Sometimes you need a parents' night out. The Legit Young Adult Ministry is partnering with LWFC Kids to provide parents with a night out on Friday, February 18th from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. Parents, register your kids on the events page on our website. Or for more information, reach out to Ms. Sylvia Edwards. We really want to give all of our parents the break that they might need. Living Word family, it's Black History Month. Journey with us through Black History Month as we learn and explore all of the history of African Americans, Texas Black history, and even the history of our own city and Acres Home. And we even want to explore the history of our very own Living Word Fellowship Church. Our history is the cornerstone and foundation of our future. Observe the wonderful displays that are in the foyer and in the children's wing, and don't miss the Silver Star's annual Black History Program. It's focused on Black health and wellness. It'll take place Saturday, February 26th in Legacy from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. It's a great time to explore our richness and our culture. Thanks. Calling all men, come and join Men's Kingdom Building Bible Study on February 19th at 9 a.m. in Legacy. This is a study of the book by Charles Stanley called Landmines, and we'll learn how to avoid the dangers that get in the way of the believer experiencing God's goodness and his blessings. Men, you don't want to miss this special event. Hey, Live Your Word family. Do you have questions about the COVID-19 vaccine, how to quarantine, or especially about the safety of giving the vaccination to your child or teen? Well, our very own Dr. Judith Campbell, or as we call her, Dr. Judy, will be here in between services at 10 a.m. on February 27th to answer all of your questions. Also, check out our newly released interviews with Pastor Paul Kane and Dr. Judy on our YouTube channel. Send any questions you have for Dr. Judy beforehand to marketing@lwfellowshipchurch.org. For the latest information on COVID-19 prevention, please check out our website. We hope to see you on February 27th.